go of it.
Bravo. Bravo.
Not such a very bad hook.
You are without a doubt an enchanting hook. A little word of warning, Miss Ralston. You must not be too trusting of these guests. Do you have references with them?
Is that usual? I always thought people just came.
It is advisable to know a little about people who sleep under your roof. Take myself, for example. I turn up saying that my car has overturned and snowdrift. What do you know of me? Nothing at all. I may be a thief, a robber, a fugitive from justice, a madman, even a murderer. Oh. You see, and perhaps you know just as little of your other guests?
Well, as far as Mrs. Boyle goes...
The drawing room is far too cold to sit in. I shall write my letters in here. Mrs. Ralston, is your husband about? I'm afraid the downstairs cloakroom pipes are frozen.
Dear, what an awful day! First the police, and then the pipes!
Police!
Police, did you say?
Yes, they rang up just now to say they're sending an inspector out here. I don't think he'll ever get here.
So the police are on their way here, right here. What?
Oh, that's all right. No one can get through within this. Why, the drifts must be at least 5 feet deep. The roads are all backed up. Nobody will get here today. What?
Yes, sir.
There is nothing, absolutely nothing. It must be a coincidence.
Superintendent Hoffman doesn't think it is a coincidence, sir. He'd have come himself if it hadn't been in any way possible. Under the weather conditions and, as I can see, he sent him with instructions to get full particulars of everyone in the house, to report back to him by phone, and to take what measures I thought fit to ensure the safety of the household.
Safety? What danger does he think we're in? Good heavens, he's not suggesting how someone's going to be killed here.
I don't want to frighten any of our guests, but frankly, yes, that is the idea.
But why?
That's what I'm here to find out.
But the whole thing's crazy.
Yes, sir. It's because it's crazy that it's dangerous.
Nonsense! I must say, it seems a bit far-fetched.
I think it's wonderful.
This is something you haven't told us, Sergeant.
Yes, Mrs. Ralston. Below the two addresses were written three blind lines. And on the dead woman's body was a paper with, "This is the first written." And below the words, a drawing of three little mice and a bar of music. The music was the tune of the nursery rhyme, Three Blind Mice. You know how it goes. Three blind mice, three blind mice, see how they run, see how they run. They all ran out to the farm as well.
Oh, it's horrible!
There were three children and one died.
Yes, the youngest, a boy of 11.
What happened to the other two?
Well, one girl was adopted by someone with no trace of her present whereabouts, and the eldest has not been heard of since. According to child psychologist records, was definitely schizophrenic. A bit different in the head, and possibly dangerous if you catch by drift.
Different? As in a homicidal maniac? A homicidal maniac will turn up here and try to kill someone?
Yes.
But why?
That's what I want to find out from you. As the superintendent Hoffman sees it, there must be some connection. Now, can I have all your names, please?
This is quite ridiculous. We're merely staying in a kind of hotel. We've only arrived yesterday. We've nothing to do with this place.
But you plan to come here in advance, though. You'd booked your rooms here ahead.
Well, yes, all except Mr. Pappuccini. His car overturned in the snowdrift, or so he says.
I see. What I'm getting at is that anyone who's been following you around might know very well that you were coming here. Now, there's just one thing I want to know, and I want to know it quick. Which one of you is it that has some connection with that business at Longridge Farm? All right then, I'll ask you one by one. You, sir, since you seem to have arrived here more or less by accident, Mr.
Paravicini. But my dear inspector, I know nothing but nothing of what you are talking about. I am a stranger in this country, and nothing of these local affairs that fight on with.
Boy, I don't see really, I consider it an impertinence. Why on earth should I have anything to do with such this distressing business?
And you are?
Caswell, Leslie Caswell. I never heard of Longridge Farm.
Then you, sir?
Metcalf, Major Metcalf. Read about the case in the papers at the time. I was stationed at Edinburgh then. No personal knowledge.
And you?
Christina Redden. Why, I was a mere child at the time. I don't remember ever even hearing about this.
And that's all you have to say? Any of you? Okay, well, if one of you gets murdered, you'll all have yourself to blame. Now then, Mr. Wilson, can I have a look around the house?
My dears, how melodramatic! I do so admire the police, so stern and hard-boiled. Quite a thrill, this whole business of three blind eyes. How's the tune though?
that door. This place is full of drafts.
Sorry, madam, but I've got to get the lay of the land.
Well, that can't be the door. Nothing suspicious. I think I'll make my report now to Superintendent Holden.
Oh, but you can't telephone. The line's dead.
What? Since when?
Major Metcalf tried it just after you arrived, and the line was dead. It was all right earlier. Superintendent Holden was all right. I suppose since then, the lines are down for sale.
I wonder. It may have been cut.
Cut? But who would have cut it?
Mr. Ralston, just how much do you know about these people who are staying in your guest house?
We don't really know anything about them. Miss Boyle from the Bournemouth Hotel, Major Metcalf only just in Leamington, Retton wrote from the Hampstead Inn, and Casewell from a private hotel in Kensington. Pavicini, as we told you, turned up last night. Still, I suppose they go about rash that sort of thing.
But even if this maniac is trying to get us here and kill us all, or one of us, we're quite safe now, because of the snow. No one can get here to the lots.
Unless they're already here. Well, why not, Mr. Ralston? These crimes will be left. Except for Mr. Pedicini, they were all booked beforehand. All these people arrived here yesterday evening, some hours after the murder of Mrs. Stenning. Plenty of time to get here.
Crimes? There's only been one crime in Cole Street. Why are you so sure that another one will happen here?
That it will happen here? No. I hope to prevent that. Then it will be attempted? Yes.
I can't believe it. It's just so fantastic.
You've got a description of what the suspect looked like in London.
In determining the height and build, yeah, we do know that they were wearing a darkish overcoat, soft felt hat, and facing by a muffler. Spoke in a whisper. There are several darkish overcoats hanging up in the hall now with lighter felt hats. You see, it's this telephone wire that worries me. If it's been cut, is there an extension, Mr. Ralston?
Yes, up in our bedroom.
Go and try it up there for me, will you?
Very well, sir.
To understand what I may term as the mechanics of fear, you have to study the precise effect produced on the human mind. Imagine, for instance, that you are alone in a room. It is late in the afternoon, a door opens softly behind you.
And now, a word from our sponsor.